Hello people, it's been a very long time since the last video and quite a bit has also happened, and as you can see, one of the major things that has happened is proper lighting for my large lathe room, so no more using headlights. Okay, and while I've been away, I've been very busy. I actually now have a running company in here. I'm taking in some work and doing it for a price, and I'm also paying taxes. And I really like all of this. So far I haven't done pretty much of any advertising, because as you can see, still see my workshop is still a little bit of a mess. So I don't want to take too much work yet, but I want to start growing my my customer contacts. And also one other thing is right here. You have seen this before, but I would say that it's now closer to being completed as it has ever been. So this is the 100% homemade 4-stroke engine made by me. You have seen it before, and I'm still working on doing a video about how I made this, but it will take so much editing work that I don't know when I have the time to do that completely. At the moment the engine is running great, and it's running an AC alternator, a DC alternator, 12 volt from a car, and it is charging a battery which is running a 1000 watt inverter, which turns the battery power into 230 volts AC for running power tools, for example. And if you like, I could do a proper video about this motor finally, now that I'm pretty happy with it. So if you would like to see a video about this, please let me know. Okay, but now today's topic is something that I and maybe even some of you have been waiting for quite a while. Remember I did a poll in the end of one of my videos, asking which lathe should I use to create a wheel hub from this piece of metal. And I get like 100 volts for this lathe and like 2 volts for the tiny lathe. So this is the day that I'm gonna make the wheel hub from this piece on this lathe. And I have already made another one, which is here. I did this on the smaller lathe. It's been in damp conditions, so it's got a little bit rust on it already. And this is still not quite finished. As you can see, it's very, very heavy, but it now fits into the car. We had to do like 5 to 10 test fits and remove a little bit of material at once to see that, to make sure that the fit is good, and now it is good. And now I'm gonna make another one like this, and then when the both ones of these fit perfectly in the car, then we will figure out how to make these lighter. And here I have some plans. I'm not a very good sketch maker, at least by drawing on my hands. But this is what I should be doing now. And I still have to recheck the inner dimensions for the bearings, and it's gonna get some dust seals in here. So these measures are not completely correct in the drawings, but the outside dimensions are correct, and that's what I'm gonna start with. So first thing to do is to get the piece set up in the forge or chuck. And let me tell you, I've been very, very satisfied with this Forge of Chuck. I really like it. And I also like dialing stuff in. It's kind of fun to see something running perfectly true. So let me get the tripod set up and let's start working. Okay, I'll let the indicating start. I think this piece weighs about 10 kilograms or 25 pounds or something like that. I think I want the piece not all the way until the chuck face. Let's have it something like this. Okay, let me get my mallet. Okay, let's continue. I will set the indicator somewhere. Let's set it here. And by the way, I got a really good deal on some measuring equipment. I have let me show you. I got three of these Noga magnetic bases, which are awesome. I love these. And also I got a few of these Mitutoyo shockproof indicators. And also I got, let me show you. This is a Mitutoyo copy, cheap Chinese copy, but I got a few of these real deals. And then I got one test indicator with a little bit longer testing arm, and also it has 3 millimeters of movement per size, so 6 millimeters. And also I got some Mitutoyo calipers and digital calipers, and also 500 millimeter Preiser and German made caliper, and also something else. It was a great deal, one of the best ones I've ever had. Okay, so let's start indicating. It's now off so much dry. I just want to try to eyeball it first. Get it running a little bit through-ish. Okay, now I think we are well within the measuring range of the indicator. So let's place it down. Something like that. We got like 2 millimeters. So I like to find the lowest spot, which is about here. And then loosen that side and then turn it 180 and tighten again. pretty good that way. Of course, this stock isn't perfectly round. Let's check the face. It sure is running off. Also, the saw cuts are never perfectly accurate either. It's running off a little bit over 1 millimeter. Let's see how it turns with the light running. By the way, I have the camera now on a mag base, and I think it will catch some of the vibrations of the lathe, so I hope the sound won't be too bad, but at least I hope the views will be pretty good. Okay, let's start. It is good enough for me. And there's a lot of material to remove. Okay. I think it's a good idea to do this side first, because this will be a good place to attach the piece again. It will be more difficult to do it on this side. So, first let's rough the outside diameter to 155. It's 15 millimeters to take off. And then we make this solder here. So, the turning speed is 360 RPM. And the feeding speed is 0.22 millimeters per revolution, which is a little under 10 thousandths per revolution. I hope you get a good view. I think you do. Making sure everything's tight. Start with 3 millimeters of diameter. Okay, let's check. So we have still lots to take off. Let's try adding a few millimeters. Now it's taking 3 millimeters per side, 6 millimeters of diameter. This is an all new insert to me. I bought a box of them, and this is the first time I'm using them. And I think it's not working in this application. I have no information actually about those inserts. So let me change to another tool. Okay, let's try this one. It's a DCMT tool. Also, it might be that the square insert tool still would have needed some more feed, but the piece is not as well fastened to the chuck as I would like, so I don't want to run it any faster. I was already going 0.4 millimeters per revolution, which is. Do the calculation yourself. Okay, now let's try how this tool does. I will lower the feed down again. Okay. This is how I like my fit. That's how I like my chips. Let me reposition. We should still have quite a bit to take off. Ten millimeters to take off, so let's see what this lathe does. Okay, let's first start with the same feed as last time. This is 3 millimeters per side, so 6 millimeters of diameter.
more. Let's try 8 millimeters of diameter, so 4 millimeters per side. And this is starting to be a little bit heavy. Doing pretty good. And now, while we still have some to take off, let's try one more tool. Just a minute. 2 millimeters per side and 4 millimeters of diameter. Feed. Not bad. Three millimeters per side. 6 millimeters of diameter. Works pretty well. Now we still have 2 millimeters to take off. Yes. Per side and 2 millimeters of diameter. Looking at the sparks, I think I should replace the insert. Okay, this is another square insert tool. Let's see how it does. Okay, that's how far I'm gonna go with this tool. Okay. let's start with 2 millimeters. And the feed is 0.22 millimeters per revolution. More to go. Surface finish is very, very good. Again, 4 millimeters. And by the way, the feed now is 0.4 millimeters per revolution, so it's pretty high. Thank you. 1.4 millimeters to go. So let's do 1.5. Actually, let's do just one and leave a little bit to finish. Tools. Okay, off camera I finished these shoulders and the face, and now I'm drilling a hole. I already have a hole going through, but this is the final size drill. So let me show you a little bit of drilling. Okay, getting ready to bore, because the bore is so small related to the bore. I'm using compressed air to blow the chips through the hole, so they will not jam between the work and the boring bore. Okay, let's see how we do. Okay, the next thing to do is to machine the bearing housing, and here you can see the outside ring of the bearing, and I'll start by using my digital Mitutoyo mic, which I absolutely love, to check the outside diameter. And the battery is almost out. You can still see the reading when you look it from the downside, but when you look at it straight, you cannot see it. I already have some new batteries, still haven't gotten into changing it. Okay, let's see what kind of a reading we get. Thirty-nine point eighty-nine. Yeah. So... I'm gonna lock the mic here. And then I'm gonna set my... also made by MitoToyo bore gauge to this dimension. And this is from 35 to 60 millimeters, and I have the 35 millimeter insert in here. So I'm gonna have to change it. Oops. I'm going for 40 millimeter. These are 5 millimeters larger. It's one of those. And if you want to go between them, you have these tiny seams that you can insert between the and this bit and between the tool itself. But since we are shooting at pretty close to 40 millimeters, I don't think we need to do anything else but have this insert in there. Now let's see if I can show this to you. I don't think I can, but what I'm doing, I'm using this mic to set the bore gauge. So I'm just zeroing the dial indicator. To this reading, which is pretty much exactly right here. Yes, that's where we are shooting. So about 3/4 of a turn to go. Okay, and this, I think this is by far the best and the most accurate method of measuring bores. It's not the fastest method because all of this setting, but it's so accurate and so dependable that I really like it. So, and of course we want the bearing race to be press fit, so I'm shooting for 2 or 3 hundredths of a millimeter of press fit. Okay, let's go to the lathe and start boring. Okay, I have both axes zeroed and we are taking off 5 millimeter from the diameter and going 24 millimeters deep. So, let's go. Okay, getting close. It's about 13 under, and I'm shooting for 2 or 3 hundredths under. So I think right now I'm gonna increase the spindle speed and drop the feed rate. So maybe we can get a little bit better finish. turned out to be a little bit rough on the surface finish. I think my insert is getting bad. But I am pretty satisfied with the size. But I must change this insert. Okay. Let's continue. Okay. Using the same methods, I turned this face for the dust cup. And now I also gave it some chamfer on the inside. And now the last thing to do is to chamfer the outside edges. Here we have it. Now ready to turn the piece around. Okay, the piece is now reversed and I did the face-off competition video right here, and that's why I didn't set the piece up as I told you earlier. But I think it's better to have it chucked up in this way, because there's quite a bit of material to remove and this is a very rigid setup. So let's have it like this until we have done most of the hogging. Okay, let's start by removing a lot of metal. Let's try more. It's 4 millimeters per side.